All right, so happy Monday, guys. Welcome to the last session of our abstract landscape. Today, we are going to use Lee Krasner as our inspiration for our landscape painting. I don't know if you got to see the video that I sent you. Usually if I go to YouTube, I go into the rabbit hole and then it's one after the other and I can't get out and start watching another video and another video and another video. So let's see. So Lee Krasner is the wife of Jackson Pollack. It's kind of neat because it's very male dominated, right? So for her to paint in a very male-dominated time and with a very, very influential husband, she must have given up a lot of her own paintings for her husband. So she actually supported him, Jackson Pollack. And made him shine. So she would be painting smaller pieces because he had his studio in the barn or whatever. Betty, you've been to his house, right? In New York? No. Were you able to go to his studio, Betty? Oh, you were already unmuted.
No, not me, unfortunately.
Oh, okay. All right, so I thought you guys managed to visit his studio. Anyway, when he died, hang on. So Lee Krasner, born 1908 to 1984, New York, Jewish background. And she started painting Cubism style, which is pretty much very... grid-like, right? Everything is pretty much a shape of a cube overlapping big cubes, small cubes, something like that, right? So she started painting pretty much like Picasso, right? And then she started doing all over inspired by Jackson Pollack. But because she had the limited space, she only had, she was painting in her bedroom, I believe, or somewhere in the house. She only had a little space, so she only had, let's say, a table to do her work. So she would do her work flat, and she would do smaller abstracts of all over composition. Now, she studied with Hans Hofmann, so... I'd like you to also take a look at his work. He is a very good colorist. I believe German background. And you will see how she was influenced by this artist, Hans Hofmann. So what we're going to do today is we're going to try her little images series. I'm just going to take a look at... to do is do some thumbnail sketches. Thumbnail sketches on your sketchbook. Maybe about three. So if you're doing it something like that. And what I'd like you to do is it's still an all over composition. So that means it's all over. The technique is kind of all over. So look at your image, which for me is my winter. So if I would draw my winter scene, it would be like this, would be the horizon line, a little area here, and then I have my trees in the forest, right? And then I have the creek, which runs this way. And then there's a little bit of that there. So that would be just my regular way of drawing. So do it regularly, like a regular way. But what will be all over is we'll divide it some more. Like we'll almost make it almost like a mosaic. And you'll know exactly what I'm talking about once my technical help comes, because then I can show you what I'm trying to have you do. So let's see here. It's not here. So this is just a regular outline sketch, right? Regular outline sketch of what I'm trying to work on. So from here, what I'm going to do is probably maybe instead of these are all gonna be segmented into little shapes. How did she call it? Little images. So she put some collage work, she put some beading, she put some stickers. So this would be now part of the foliage of that tree. So let's say maybe I'll do it up here, which would make more sense. So instead of painting the trees the way you would normally do, you would make them into little images. So you would divide them into more of like the cubism style, right?
My lighted option.
Oh, Betty, I can hear you.
No, that's not me.
Oh, who is that? Sharon? Oh, okay. So now you've got even the trees can now be segmented into a little image. So this tree can now become a different cube. Everything will just be broken down into more shapes. So I think the best way to attack this is to do a thumbnail sketch of your image first. And then you can break it up into little images. And then what you could do is you can put some color, right? So let's have some colored pencils here. So just right now, just maybe focus on, okay, what color will I use to portray my trees in the forest? So this is blue. So maybe I'll do blue, do different shades of blue, and then maybe another kind of blue here. Because it's an abstract, right? So it doesn't have to be real. You can exaggerate. You can make it out of this world. And each of those shapes, each of those little images will be part of your landscape. Was that as just clear as mud, isn't it? The way we normally paint, we're segmenting it into smaller. Maybe you can even think mosaic. Mosaic might actually help with getting everything into little images. So another way here, these are really tiny, right? Tiny. All of that will all be like a little mosaic piece, but you could still see the landscape. And every little piece is almost the same size. So almost the same size. So same size for each of the squares. You have a line which breaks the squares, but all the squares in the middle are almost all the same size. So okay, squares are all same size, and then the line will break the little images or the cubes. So first things first. Do an outline sketch of your drawing, of your picture, of your landscape. Then you integrate all the background into small little images, all same size. You will have outlines of your image, like this is my creek, that will stay as a line, but everything in here will still be a cube, will be a little image. So everything will be all cubism. She was inspired by that. But now each little image, each little cube is its own painting. Did that just break your heart? Each little cube could stand on its own. So let's say this is the creek. I want this to be blue. And then maybe I want this to be brown. And then maybe I want this to be green. I don't know if that translates well because it's colored pencil. But I think that'll be a really, really good exercise to push you out of the regular way of painting a landscape. This is going to be a little bit more complicated. Okay, so those are little lines, little images. Now, if you want and you want to really simplify, so let's say I'll do it again. Here we go. These are just opportunities for you, just ideas. That's the same creek, same trees. Same leaning tree there, few trees here. If you want, you can make your squares bigger. There's still little images, but bigger than that. So maybe instead of a 2x2, you can make it a 4x4, right? So bigger shapes. And look at my painting. Bigger shapes, right? Bigger shapes, but all a cubist style. This is not quite like hers, but this is a Marissa, right? But I'm just giving you some ideas on how you can make it more cubist. So this could be an inch, let's say 2 inch big, and then here it could be 1 inch or half an inch.
On what size canvas then?
Up to you. Okay. So this is Lee Krasner, right? So those are her cubism, that's how her how she started, right? So this one, you can see it's very Picasso-like. Very cubism. It's all about shape and geometric overlapping grids, right? So, and then she went into this is the little images. Now she had insomnia, so she was working at night. And because she couldn't see colors very, very well, her color palettes were browns and blacks and really deep, dark colors. So it's because she can see it at night, because at night is when she was painting. And so all her pieces are mostly in the dark hues. But later on in her life, she did something like this. And this is where I'd like you to go. See how beautiful it is, and it is just shape over shape, over shape. So that's paintings with some collage work. I mean, you could see it. It was an all over composition. yeah, very, very, very cool. So this is kind of, you know, I'd like you to sort of get to this part, incorporating also this, which is very cubism. But I want you to have nicer, brighter colors. It's up to you if you want to do it more gray and black and white, which is very contemporary. It's very much in today. But if you'd like to do your landscape in a more colorful way, this is kind of where I'd like you to head for. So that'll just give you an idea on how to break down your shapes into smaller shapes. So from big shape, it's like this landscape here, see this? From a big landscape, oops, that's my camera, and then you divide it into smaller cubist style shape. Still a landscape, but divided by color and divided by pieces and line. That's kind of where I'd like it to go.
Marissa, what do you mean by collage? Sorry, I've never...
Collage is adhering paper onto your canvas. So it's like decoupage. It's like it's adhering any piece of paper onto your canvas, and you can use polymer medium for that.
I have an example of that if you want handy.
Sure. Show it, Betty.
Would you use like decoupage glue? Like the thin glue?
You could use that, but I would use polymer if you have it. That's really nice.
Can you
see Betty's?
Mm-hmm. I don't know. Can you see it?
Yeah. So is that paper and then you paint it
on? Paper that I've painted on. Paper. Different paper. All sort of different types of papers and styles.
Okay.
Very nice, Betty.
Thank you.
Yeah, so if you, let's see here, palette. So let's say this is just a map from National Geographic, right? So if you have polymer, this is polymer, right? You can put that in a container. Let's just put that here, a little container there. You put the polymer on your container, and then with the paintbrush, you can, let's say this one here. Let's say I want the blue as my shape for my canvas. I'll just stick it down. I'll also do that here, and then you adhere it on where. So that's collage. The act of sticking down paper onto paper. So instead of painting, you can actually do this whole painting with collage if you want. Or you can have alternate. Maybe you can have collage in between your painting, but okay. Then
and I could also paint on the paper that I collage.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So let's say that you want that it's dry. You can go ahead and paint on top of it.
I might try that. Be my first time collaging.
Yeah. You can use decoupage. I would use polymer or even gel if it's thicker. Yeah, if you have managed to get polymer, that would be great. I would tear rather than cut, because it's softer. You get softer lines, and you can overlap. right? So you can, of course, I'll put glue here again, which I just put away. So I can put that glue there, and then you can overlap, because that is cubism, could be overlap or side by side.
Okay.
So that's another option. But first, maybe what you could do is decide on your, if you're going to do your shapes big or you're going to do your shapes smaller. Now, if we look at Lee Krasner here, she had smaller shape within a big shape. So you could still divide it some more, right? They're little images, so they are in its own piece of artwork. So she went in and did another grid on top of a grid, which is part of a grid painting. Yes? No, maybe? Okay. But this is kind of where I'd like you, you know, bring in some color into your piece. And that'll be really nice. So I'm going to paint with you. I'm going to paint flat. And I'll show you how I'm going to do it first. So once I start painting, maybe you can go ahead and follow. Okay. All right. So how are we going to do this, right? I don't know. Are we going to put a wash? Are we doing... Yeah. So let's see here. Leaving it there because it needs some color. My palette. So here is my palette. That's my canvas. So I'm using a small canvas because I have limited space here. And let's say maybe I'll transfer my drawing. Let's transfer my drawing. I didn't do a wash. I think I have to do a wash. All right. Because I always start with a wash. So let's do a wash just with water. And I'm going to do a wash in my usual red. Up to you what wash you'd like to use, what color you'd like to use. Maybe I'll do a little wash here. So I'm using just ordinary Amsterdam, and I'm gonna go in with a big brush. So what you could do too is you could do washes on different areas. So sorry, that became a little blurry because it doesn't understand, my camera doesn't understand white. It has to see color. So let's say I'm going to do a wash right here. It's my forest, right? So I'm just doing a little bit of water. Just a little bit of wash there. That's my trees, my forest. And that's all right there. Just do a little quick wash. Just using water. And not worried about placement. So too, if you want something smooth, I usually, when I do something smooth, I smoosh it. So with a paper towel, I kind of like to sort of go around and soften the line by smooshing. It's different than smooshing in a cocktail party, but it's mingling. right there. So now we have a softer wash. And maybe that'll be that. And then maybe at the bottom, I could maybe choose a different color. Maybe I'll choose just because. Maybe I'll choose a blue gray because I like this color, which I just bought. It's grayish blue. And do the same thing. This is all nice and dry. My wash has been applied with water and color and has been smooshed so that I have softer wash. So now I'm gonna look at my sketch, which is this one here, and I'm gonna use this as my base for my little images based on Lee Krasner. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna chalk in my outline. So my outline, I had a horizon line here and I had this thing there, and then the start of the creek and went like this. Maybe I had a tree here and another tree there, and a few trees here. So that's kind of where that goes. Simple, dilapidated old. I'm just gonna give myself just an idea of my line. Remember, she did cubism, right? So here's part of the cubist style. So when Jackson Pollock died, she moved to his studio. And when she moved to his studio, she was able to work bigger. So if you see some of her work, it's huge. Like a whole room. Because then she could work on the floor and really spread out and do a real good all over composition. So that's kind of my first go. And because I want you to think of more or less like a mosaic type of work. This is just the beginning stage, right? This is kind of where I'd like you to go by breaking down pieces of a big shape into small shape. So your trees, your mountains, I want you to break that down a little bit more. Each tree will have different colors within the greens. You'll have different greens within a big green. If you're doing water, you'll have a different color water. You can have it all in squares, like shapes, big shape, small shape. And then you can divide it further. So really, you control your own painting, right? I'm just giving you guidance as to how you may want to go with it. I don't even necessarily know how I'm going to go with this, because it's all within you. It's your muse, right? Yeah, abstract is just so intellectual that way. So if you want to show me your images, maybe now's the time. Maybe, if you want. Anyone have a question?
Okay.
Everybody got that? So I'm going to put in my colors in first, and then further divide it with different colors, and then put some black lines to make them their own little image. Yeah. And then again, experiment with different colors too, right? Let's say you're doing your forest, like I am. Instead of doing it green, maybe I'll do it red. And then maybe my snow, instead of making it white, then I'll make it all blue and white and a different kind of blue. So this will change because that's the way it is. That's the way with an abstract. It changes with your mood. It changes with how the painting is working with you. It's going to change with where your hand goes. It's all intuition. So it's very hard to do a step-by-step with an abstract. I can only guide. So we'll try to do this and continue. And let's see. Watery. But I kind of like to have a little bit of polymer. So I still don't know how my squares are going to turn out. If they're going to be big or small, so I'll start big first, because I can still split this. If you look, this is a big square. Once that dries, I could go in with another color on top of it and it becomes a smaller square. Just try to be consistent all the way through and with your shapes, so that if they're all small, then you make it all small. Let's take a look again at her piece. Right, she's got here, it's almost all equal, but there are small shapes within a big shape. And here, you can see a few big shapes, but the majority are all small. Smaller pieces here, right? So you can probably emphasize your sun as a big shape, and then everything else is small. if you have clouds, your clouds could be small. Something like that. So it depends on what you're painting too, but that's...
Across Ontario, more workers are joining the skilled trade as industries in the north become part of the future of electric vehicles.
And this one here... don't know what she's talking about here. Like, what is she trying to say? She's trying to say she can't sleep at night, and so therefore these are her squares. But so I'm just gonna put in color where my trees are. And then I can break that up later on. piece is similar to her black and white one, right? Similar. It's very grid-like. It's all patchy. It's almost like a quilt. And it would look like this one, right? Almost like very, very graphic and quilt-like squares. And then she just segmented little squares within a square. So I'm starting like this, and it may end up like that, or it may end up like this. So there's two ways, you depending on where your brush goes, you might end up like this, or you can be like that, and it's still based on a landscape. Now, if you're looking at my piece, I have two lights coming down in my studio. I have a yellow light and I have white light, and I have daylight coming in. So the glare definitely kicks back to the camera. So things are not as brilliant as it could be. But you get, this is just red. This here is a blue on top of a purple. And this one is raw sienna, but just one coat. They're all very transparent right now, so we'll layer a few more colors to that. I'm going in with yellow ochre. It's raw sienna, right? Yellow ochre here. I'm gonna add some polymer. deeper greens. If you could see a change there, see if you could see this is cadmium red here compared to the other color here, which is just a bright red. So cadmium red is deeper and warmer. Or there's a little bit of glare. We'll see where that goes. Let's bring in some colors here.
So, Marissa, have you added glazing liquid to that? Because cadmium is usually transparent. Is it?
Cadmium is, let's see. It is semi-transparent. Because you can still see the lines, right?
Yeah.
I still added polymer to it.
You did?
Yeah.
That's what I wanted.
Yeah. Yeah, I still, the whole painting will be finished with paint and polymer. You know, in collage. So, it's just nice. Colors upon color upon color. We'll see where it goes. We don't know where it goes. It's exploration. Is anybody doing more black and white stuff? Like what Lee Krasner did? Or are we all dealing with color?
Color.
Okay. All right. I kind of like to have the color.
To see you, are you, where is your polymer on your palette, and how often are you dipping your brush in and all that jazz?
So my polymer is here.
Okay.
Right? So let's say I'm getting my paint.
Yeah.
I get a little bit of it. And then
okay.
And then I bring it back in here, and then I don't go back there anymore.
Okay.
So my brush has polymer already. If I'm sticking to this color, this red. I already went in there.
Right.
I went back in here to load my paint.
Uh-huh.
I'm not going to go back into the polymer anymore.
Are you attempting to achieve a specific consistency with your paint with the polymer, or just going with the flow of whatever's on your brush and whatever's...
Not more consistency, but I want it to dry equally rather than, because with water it will dry in some spots that are lighter, and here with the polymer it's sort of like like the glue that keeps everything together. So it'll all dry equally, the same.
But you don't have polymer, what do you use?
Use glazing liquid.
If you can't go back, but you can't go back into the polymer because it still is wet. It's kind of like retarder in that sense. Like you couldn't go in with a different color into that polymer.
Oh, yeah, you can.
Oh.
Yeah, you can.
With what? A different color or with the same color?
So, I mean, like, if I want to change now, like, let's say I want to go into the blues, or I want to go into a different color, so I want to go back into the yellow ochre. So I'll clean my brush. Brush is all clean. I'll go back into the yellow ochre, and then I'll add a little polymer to it. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. And then with every... But I don't want to go and keep coming back with too much polymer, because then it's just going to be slip-sliding away. Like, it's not doing anything. I already have polymer in my brush, so I'm okay with that. So I can go into here and just keep going into the main dish. I don't have to keep going back to the polymer. I just keep coming back here.
Okay. Thank you.
Does that clear up the mud? Yeah. I like the paint to dry equally all throughout. If you're using water, it's just gonna be some areas will have dried first and the other area it hasn't dried yet. This just keeps it all even, the drying time. Now I made you more confused. You know, it takes a while to get used to it, and then go back. So I'm going back into my grayish blue now. So that's my grayish blue. I'll touch my polymer. I'll go back in there, and then that's it. Now I have polymer in my brush, and I'm just going into the grayish blue, and I'll go and apply that down here. So if you want, I mean, just because it's in a class, right? So experiment with polymers. See how, did you try it before? You should try it.
I tried it week one and it was a hot mess because I think I used too much polymer and all I kept doing was pushing the paint all over the place.
Yeah, not too much. Just get it through your brush. Once it's in your brush, that's all you need. So right now, my squares are all the same. They're all coming down that way. So if you look at this image here of Lee Krasner, she has her... she has her squares coming from different directions. So some are tilting to the left, some are tilting to the right. She's got some triangular shape. She's got long, thin, rectangular. She's got the smaller squares that lead into a curl. I'm looking at the, you know, some of her smaller shapes lead to a little bit of a paisley design, like it curls from blue to white to yellow to black to green, all those little small. So if you could even break down further your squares to indicate leaves in smaller squares within the square. That's kind of neat, how she did this. Now her canvas is round too, which, you know, could be a nice tabletop. Right now my painting is looking more like this, right? It's more linear. So we'll see. I have quite a ways to do still. Hour, right? So things, right? By doing all my abstracts, I have started to paint Marissa Way, but you will see how what influenced me a lot. Certainly not Pollack, but Kandinsky for sure. Mark Rothko, I love his very simplistic style, how he started, and the grids, the cubism. Picasso really influenced me as well as Claude Monet. So it's become boom with all this. So I hope to see you again in another class.
Yes.
And if you have any questions, send me your images and I will help you and guide you along and give you a good critique.
Thank you.
Thanks
so much, Marissa. This has been a
wonderful class.
Love learning about
Marissa.
These artists.
Did you enjoy yourself?
Yeah,
thank you very much.
Uh-huh. Looking forward to seeing your finished product.
Bye.
Marissa, is it okay to reach out via Instagram as opposed to email?
Yeah, you can reach out on Instagram because we're following each other now.
It's easier.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, for sure. Well, thank you guys, everybody. And we'll keep in touch, okay?
Okay. All right.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.